one of the larger issues which have always been talked about is, and I saw that a brief mention of that as well, the role of pricing. And there has been this huge debate about both for and against about how pricing will unleash an investment in the sector. There have been different contrarian views as well. I would like to get Deepak to start with on this. There has been this Rangarajan committee report. There was a decision as well. There are PILs in the Supreme Court today. How does this take the sector forward, and how important is pricing to the entire debate?
Right. From different contexts, the answer can be different. And since I am in an educational institute, I am going to be balancing all interests, because I can see some future economists, some social beneficiary persons, some capital industry captains, as well as government planners or regulators sitting in the audience.
Right.
From a socialistic context, affordability of energy across India is a serious challenge. Typically, the conversations that we have about energy policy people are converged around affordability of the investors, whereas affordability from consumer standpoint also is of an important connotation in these discussions. For whatever reasons it may be, and seriously laden with political interests, we are not able to pass on the cost of energy to the consumers, and therefore we are not able to increase the price of any inputs of primary energy costs that are happening. So therefore, affordability is restricted in passing it on to the right targets.
Right.
If I don't look back as to why it is happening, obviously the interest of investors is going to be in price to be high, so that their investment margins are higher and they're able to take larger risks. Now the whole question then comes in the context of India as to where investments in energy sector and assets is required. Our prime importance today is to attracting investors, or is it to make energy affordable? And I must tell you, the context that we are discussing on the panel was no different when Enron project came up, sir, on your exactly same discussions were happening as to whether we can afford to have 1 point whatever paisa.
So there's a larger affordability versus investment issue that needs to be taken care of before, and that is the larger issue, right?
It is.
Right.
And primary energy industry will always seek higher prices, and it's rational.
Absolutely. Thank you, Deepak. In fact, I would also like other panelists, primarily Mr. Singh and Mr. Dugal, to weigh in here, and your views on the issue, and if there is anything that you would also like to add to that you would like to be focused during this discussion as well. Why don't you start?
I think I have a slightly different take. Probably what is happening is that we are not at all seized of the problem at all if we are looking at it in this manner. Because the issue is, when you look at the global scenario, just to give you an idea, today we actually consume around 85 million barrels of oil, and equivalently when you look at gas, it is around some 55 million barrels of oil equivalent of gas which we consume every day. Now going forward, the fields are declining. For oil, probably we would be by 2030 short of nearly 30 million barrels. And for gas, it will be roughly around some 20 million barrels. So 50 million barrels gone. So if you really add these to 85 and 55, it's around 140. 50 gone, you left with 90 only. And if the today's trend goes forward, with global level, if you see some 1.8% or 2% of growth in these sectors which is happening, actually you will end up at a demand of nearly around 180 million barrels. So the whole idea is that we are anyway short of huge amount of energy in oil and gas. Now let me paint another picture. You have today around 7 billion people in the world. And when you look at that, this is going to grow to nearly around 10 billion at that point of time. So one way the kitty is shrinking, and the consumption people are increasing in a huge number.
Right.
So there is a huge amount of competition on this. Now let me also give you another flavor. In the US today, when they use automobiles, I'm just giving you one consumption pattern. Probably every 1,000 people are actually having access to nearly 800 cars. when you look at the Indian market, we are around 30-35 cars per thousand. You look at China, it is also around the same number. Mm-hmm. But you look at the population now, 3 million people actually having, or sorry, 30 million people actually having a huge amount of access to 800 cars a thousand. And here you have 1.2, 1.3 billion people added up, nearly around, say effectively, I would say nearly 3 billion people into the system. Mm-hmm. And they are consuming very less. So if their consumption goes higher, you can imagine what's going to happen.
We are in a spot.
So the point is, are we really missing the forest for the wood here? Mm-hmm. We are debating on a few cents, few dollars here and there, etc.
Right.
Does it really, is this the problem which we should address at this point of time? So I would rather say, on a larger perspective, mm-hmm. anything, because today we have around 287 PS production sharing contracts running.
Sorry, I'm interrupting you, but are you saying there's a lot of unnecessary noise out there and the real issues are not being taken care of at this point of time? There is a lacuna on the part of the either the policymakers or the larger polity as well, which is played out the way it has played out.
I think I wouldn't actually say that, because everybody is seriously looking at it.
Right.
But the issue is that what Mr. Deepak mentioned, that you have the investor and you have the consumer. Mm-hmm. Now, unless and until this chain gets complete, business is not happening.
Absolutely.
So you have to take both people into account.
Right.
But what I'm now trying to say here is that, look, in the world, every physical molecule you grab today, mm-hmm. is needed to be grabbed, because if you don't wake up today, someone else will take it away.
That is a quest for resources which is happening elsewhere.
So therefore the
We'll come to that. That's sure. one of the topics that I would like you, because GAIL has been at the forefront of acquiring assets overseas. They have had one of the most successful track record in getting shale gas assets in US. I think you are the first of the block from India for that, amongst the first of the block. I would like to Mr. Dugal to weigh in here. When we look at gas and this narrative of economic resurgence which is being talked about, how important is the role of gas, and how will it help kickstart this economy where there have been all kind of naysayers around?
Thank you for the invitation and for a complex question. Mm. But I would like to just take it slightly differently. Mm-hmm. The price of gas, let's look at it. It can be analyzed both in terms of sensitive demand, which is sensitive to price. I mean, gas price is sensitive. Other is insensitive. So you do have pooling. We do have pooling at the end of the electricity sector. Now, there ought to be a pooling at the gas sector as well. There's nothing called free lunch. We are the price takers, so more of LNG import is going to come into the country. Now, let's look at from the consumer's perspective, which are the anchor load customers. If you look at fertilizer, we need food security. Already everything is a pass-through. But something which has really failed to happen in this country is what Kanukaran also gave, that number was 5 MMSCMD out of the total LNG kitty is getting consumed in power sector. I think that's the key. Mm-hmm. That's the key aspect to it. And there are further two dimensions to it. Let's look at what are the T&D losses in the power sector. I would like from the audience, to the students, to calculate 1% saving in the T&D loss. What is the impact on the affordable price of power? And it basically travels backward into the imputed value of fuel. Let's also look at it the way forward. If you increase the price of power by 1 rupees per kilowatt hour, probably you are addressing the affordability of gas price or RLNG to the extent of $3 MMBTU. The solution is something which is homegrown. You don't need to look at it from an outward perspective. I think that's the key part of it. And we need to look at what are the other sectors which are waiting for the power to come. Mm-hmm. Let's look at Gurgaon. That example which was made in the first panel was, we are paying 17 rupees per kilowatt hour for diesel based power.
Right.
Now, is that not a criminal waste of resource? Gas can do an excellent bridging aspect, the peaking power requirements.
Yeah, I believe there's
So those kind of things. And we are now increasingly looking at, Gurgaon. Virtually every other major city in the country is, becoming like Gurgaon. On the other hand, I agree with what Mr. Prabhat Singh also said. What exactly gas is basically facing is the problem is with regards to the alternative fuel pricing.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to have, where do you want to keep subsidy? At the importer point, generation point, at the consumption point.
So this is this larger issue of subsidy which needs to be addressed.
And exactly. Course, yeah. So the issue is basically when you are looking at, you are able to still get a subsidy on LPG cylinder.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I fail to understand. I don't think so. Any single person in the room deserves to have a subsidy on LPG. But when you are to price your PNG domestic in the city gas distribution against a already subsidized fuel, you can always afford to go to a 5-star hotel and basically pay a bill which will be more than the price of an LPG cylinder in a month. Now, what are we talking of? Do we really deserve to have subsidy? I think Dr. Mayaram in the first panel very clearly he outlined that, do we really need the subsidy? Take care of that subsidy, affordability, investments, infrastructure, I think all is going to fall in place.
And solution falls into place. Right. In fact, when you talked about one of the very interesting themes that have emerged since morning when you talk about the targeting of subsidy and what is real subsidy as well. We have seen that when we look at LPG in direct benefit transfer, there have been a significant number of households which have not linked their Aadhaar card. The seeding hasn't happened because they don't want. That's one of the things which I've also realized over a period of time, and which is a lot of policy planners, it has come like a surprise to them that how there is a significant chunk of population which doesn't want to be given this benefit which they don't deserve as well. I wanted to get Mr. Hari in here. You talked about there's only a limited number of basins have been explored. Also, there have been a lot of delayed projects. Cane in particular, you guys have been, when we look at your assets in Rajasthan, there has been long pending delay. I believe you have gone to Cabinet Committee on Infrastructure on that now. Where this stems from, and is how do you kickstart this production? Because there's a lot of acreages which are there. You also talked about how it takes around 31, 33 years here as compared to 6 and 12 years elsewhere. What is wrong here?
Okay, so I think basically as a private oil producer in the country, for us it's all a question of, when we look at it from a business point of view, it's all a question of where do you put your resources in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so today I have oil which is fetching me $100 a barrel, and I have gas which is fetching me $4.2 per MMBTU. On a like-to-like comparison, that comes to something like $24-$25. Okay, so the biggest question for me is, why should I go and put my resources on something which, where do I put my resources?
Mm-hmm.
And these resources could be, and these are very expensive resources. The cost of drilling a well onshore, costs about 10-12 million bucks. If it is offshore deep water, mm-hmm. it's 100 million bucks, okay? So where do I go and put my resources? I would definitely, as a private business, like to put my resources where I get the best return. I think that's pretty much where we are.
Yeah, but you're still very carefully, you have sidestepped the question. The question to you was, what's wrong? Because you guys have been taking this with the government for a long period of time, and I think CCI is the last resort to you.
Yes, so we've been, okay. So yes, we do understand that there is a social political issue here,
mm-hmm.
and I think all what we are saying is that it really doesn't make sense. If we were not in the oil business, if you look at all the gas producers, one reason why they are able to sustain, I believe, financially, is because all of them are in the oil business.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's almost like a cross subsidy for us within the sector, where the money we make on oil almost would start disappearing in gas because the cost of productions are high.
Right.
And
ever the specter of subsidy which is there,
yes.
And this is not purely an economic problem. This is a social and political problem as well. Someone has to actually, of course, the government has been doing a lot of stuff. They have been talking about how to reduce subsidy. Of course, but we are also getting into an election year.
Yeah.
So, and it will be very difficult for some of these things which have been stated to play out. Deepak, I wanted to ask you this. When we are talking about kickstarting the economy, all these assets which have been there, you have been working with some of these major companies. Is this a solution there around? As in, is there light at the end of this tunnel? Will it happen? Will it happen in a 6 months period? Will it happen in a year period? And all these initiatives like CCI and others, are they really working?
Is this question specifically from kickstarting ENP or in general energy?
Kickstarting ENP, and of course it will have to play out for the economy as well. There will be some, there will be a larger impact as well.
Right. I want to be a little more optimist on the panel. what's happening today is fantastic.
Uh-huh.
It's a balance between social interests and capital interests that are taking place.
Mm-hmm.
In a democratic country like India, I can't expect decisions to be taken at a flash speed like you would have expected them from a GCC country, let's say, mm-hmm. from allocation of resources, pricing, attributions, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start quickly, and I won't take more than 3-4 minutes. Mm-hmm. First and foremost is any decision taken in policy or regulations in exploration production industry to incentivize investment and operationalize it to end product it into a crude and oil production. This mm-hmm. doesn't happen in months or days. We can't be impatient. By reading newspapers in the morning, we can't say, will this decision come out today or in the next parliament session?
Mm-hmm.
And even if it does, its effect is going to be seen after minimum a decade,
mm-hmm.
right? So there will be issues of the nature of what's the next step to be taken into a particular investment, and these activities will happen. But any policy direction changing and any impetus to the E&P industry taking place will take effects of maybe anything between 7 to 10 years. So does the solution lie in exploration production industry, few assets to be, I would say, accelerated on their actions in possibility? That must be done, undoubtedly. Mm. If the country has to look forward to domestic production, those issues need to be quickly resolved and got forward.
Long-term horizon.
But what we are talking of is one or two assets getting operationalized
and
few tons or million tons of oil getting produced and thereafter gas getting produced. That's not going to resolve the situation of India.
Mm-hmm.
What we today need in our last estimate was something like 2,000 million tons oil equivalent of oil and gas in 2030.
Mm-hmm.
That's not going to happen by one or two fields. So what we're talking of is if we want domestic oil and gas production, current regime or the manner in which transparency is demanded, manner in which operators are supposed to behave,
mm-hmm.
not going to work. We definitely need something more friendlier to the investors.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there is a drastic change in the manner in which the investments are going to happen. The very fact that NELP rounds are not happening further and that there is a relook taking place, we
absolutely
sincerely hope mm-hmm. that a step is taken directly in that format rather than just relooking at few aspects of this investment.
Mm-hmm.
Second, share of natural gas, our prediction in PwC was that India will be about 253 to about 400 BCM of gas by 2030. Now 400 BCM means 1200 MMSCMD, and we are still talking about 80 and 100 MMSCMDs.
Right.
So by 2030, India has a normal potential of consuming something like 1200 BCM. It's a reality.
Uh-huh.
If somebody wants to dispute me, please come up and I'll give you all the calculations.
No, sorry.
So closing on this natural gas point is, be it through imported routes or through domestic production, and domestic production we are saying cannot happen in the near future,
mm-hmm.
therefore other resources have to be stuck to. And therefore, if all this has to happen and the economy has to grow at least at 6%, we need to do something drastically. LNG terminals need to be opened up, gates need to be opened up to get gas into place, and infrastructure needs to happen. If all this doesn't happen, what will happen? Clearly, there is an effect on economy. If energy is not available, forget about its affordability, the accelerated domestic production will not happen.
Right. Mr. Singh, when we, of course, when you look at the way that the gas is being sourced as well, and of course, a lot of people, not only in this room, but also elsewhere, they look at GAIL as, in times like these, GAIL as a company would go out and would seek resources. You have been trying to lock in long-term contracts as well. One of the issues which has been part of the panel discussion was when we talk about this pricing unlocking potential. One of the issues which have been raised about is that while gas prices increased from $1.79 per MMBTU, which was in 2005, to $4.2 per MMBTU, the investment and output has dropped. How would you counter that argument?
Let me, the point of actually looking at the price affordability in the Indian market today,
mm-hmm.
I'll just divide this into two parts.
Sure.
One is that you have the fertilizer and power sector who consume,
mm-hmm.
and that is nearly 65% to 70%,
mm-hmm.
and then balance 30% are the people who consume gas on a say market base.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now fertilizer and power, whatever happens,
mm-hmm.
is actually policy driven from the government side.
Sure.
So to say that the market will absorb this, etc. is not true, because market forces are truly not being unleashed to really make it happen. So all what we from the business point of view, if we try and look at that, I'll just give you an example, say of a real estate, no? Say for me instance, when I was thinking of buying a house, every time I went to the market to buy a house, I was some 5 lakhs, 7 lakhs short. So I said, sorry, I cannot buy. But one day my wife pushed me. She said, no, you have to buy this plot. We have a Gale society in sector 62. So there I said, okay, so I, some people helped me out, bank from SBI, loan, etc. happened. And I bought that house.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, to own a place in, like Delhi is a,
All I'm trying to tell you is that I bought it at a time when it was 16 lakhs. Today it is a crore rupees.
Congratulations again.
So thank you so much. But the point is, when you really look at the gas pricing also, when the price was 1.7 and people were offering 2.V and Gale offered with Petronas some $3 for 25 years.
Right, right.
People said, oh, it's so expensive, we cannot buy it. No? And then that opportunity went away. Then when the prices were declared as 4.2, people said 3 was very good. No, why don't you give it to that? give us that. Then slowly, even that, now today, RLNG, which was being done by Qatar, today has come to nearly $12. So effective.
Right.
People say that you give me $4.2 gas. Now when you go to the spot market, you have $14, $16. People say, Qatar gas, you please give it to me. So all I'm trying to say is that price is a mind application. And when you mentioned 17 rupees a kilowatt hour, somebody has given me a figure from the power sector itself,
right,
that 1 lakh crores worth of power has been purchased year before last for 12 to 14 rupees a kilowatt hour. So it's not that the economy doesn't have the power to pay.
Right.
But somewhere down the line, you need to actually create the environment for business to play. And on the policy side, the government has to really look into it and see, you know, what is better.
Absolutely. Mr. Dugal, you work for a state-owned company. And of course, there have been questions. In fact, the people in the private sector talk about how the state-owned companies, and it's also a historical reason behind it as well, always have an advantage. I don't agree to that because there is the way that the sector has opened up, everyone has got a fair chance to go and compete. Mr. Singh talked about how the government needs to take these decisions so that there is this, this is more of an application, where there is a demand for that kind of energy and there are people willing to pay for it, government has to step in. How does the government do it? And because you guys will be putting in your inputs for the government, because government, every time they want to come up with something, they will look at professionals like you, energy captains, who would like to give their point of view and how can it be played out. How will it play out? I'm not talking about the way it is here today. After the Rangarajan committee has happened, a Kelkar committee is meeting. Post 2017, there will be the entire energy landscape would change. How will this work out?
See, I was about to Mr. Prabhat Singh,
and please feel free to do so.
I fully agree with the statement that he made. In response to that, how much of power has been purchased?
Right.
Let's look at it, and also a correlation with regards to the investment. I mean, I'd like to first address that issue. Having linked the energy gas price to the hubs. Today we know that the price is expected to be around $8.3 MMBTU if it is linked to the NBP, Henry Hub, and JCC. Let's look at it, and we also hope that investment would come at this level. But let's put it the other way around. With shale energy coming in, if the Henry Hub prices were to crash further, or would suppose to hold at that level, NBP prices were to come down as a result of further recession deepening into Europe, and maybe a revival of nuclear energy in Japan, assuming this price were to come down to say $4, back to $4 MMBTU, does it mean that the investment would not happen? That's my question. That's the issue. So what we need to look at it is, what is the long-term story for energy intensity in India?
Right.
And we should not be looking at, today I started off the statement by saying that we are energy takers, price takers. Suppose the situation, there was a time when Mr. Prabhat Singh rightly said, $3.3 MMBTU was an enigma. And I remember that, 10 million tons of offer from Petronas, in fact, was refused. Because I still remember that in the first gas conclave in 2003, where the power sector Doyens, they made a positional statement saying that nothing more than $2.5 MMBTU.
Yeah.
And we lost a golden opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
See, the solution is very much out here. Now, let's look at it from the government perspective. If you are looking at, you know, kind of pooling, you know, that's a something which ought to be done when the prices are very high. And that is, but naturally it is happening in power sector. Why it should not happen in, you know, gas sector as well?
Mm-hmm.
That's something like, you know, it's a kind of a pathetic position to look at 5 MMSCMD of RLNG is only being given to the power sector.
There is a peaking power policy which is being talked about now, and they are.
It's time of the day tariff.
Yeah.
Now, when we look at, you know, the solutions are very much out here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the gas basically starts struggling in terms of the alternative fuel pricing. You know, that's the kind of a policy if you're, you know, following, which is little complicated and it has issues in terms of political, social dimensions, in terms of pricing, then obviously gas takes a backseat.
Mm-hmm.
But within that also, there is a lot of gas which is, you know, demand is there for the not so price sensitive sector,
mm-hmm.
which has to be reached.
So you're saying that going forward, say there's a nuclear resurgence happening, shale gas has already played out, there's a US economy has revived and the numbers are firming up for them. So, and there will be a time when these prices will also come down. So we are looking at a projection of $8, which was later corrected to 6.83. There will be a time when, and even if then prices take a downward swing, investment will keep on happening given
obviously.
The latent demand in the sector itself in the economy. Mr. Hari, I wanted to ask you this, and I know it's not by design that this question comes to you. so. While on one part, these are the larger policy issues which are there and for the planners and the captains like you to dwell upon, there is this, it has been termed as activism, say on institutions such as CAG and others, where a certain operator has been taken to task, there have been all kind of reports which are coming out. DGH, the Office of Director General of Hydrocarbons has taken up cudgels against a certain number of operators. And so, how do you take care of this policy? As someone in the private sector, how do you take care of these policy roadblocks? You need a window which takes care of everything. One, this management committee meeting don't happen on time and all of that.
Yeah.
All of this is supposed to be taken care of by that Kelkar committee. They have been looking at reorganizing the entire thing. Your views on the same?
Yeah, so I think coming back to the, so before that I just wanted to, so one of the mysteries in India, I think, on all our pricing is that, so on one side you have imported LNG which is coming in at, okay, $12, $14, $16, and on the other side you have a great reluctance
mm-hmm.
for the price increase to be given to the domestic gas producers. Even in the price that is fixed for the domestic gas producers, so you have the production sharing contracts. Now, a lot of these production sharing contracts actually allow us, so some of the production sharing contracts that we have talks about selling these gas on an arm's length basis. Okay, so it's not even necessary for us to go to the government if you go strictly by the PSC terms.
Yeah, but then the Supreme Court ruling changed all of that.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
And then there is a, okay, so there is this thing.
Yeah, right.
The other issue is that for every MMBTU, so I can say this for crude,
mm-hmm.
that for every dollar per barrel
mm-hmm.
Increase or a price that you realize for crude, nearly 80% goes back to the government. And the percentage may not be so high for gas, but I'm sure it is somewhere between 60 and 70%.
So what you're saying is that anyway, that money which the government gets accrued to the government, you take care of your subsidy programs
exactly.
from there.
So a lot of that money goes back to the government in form of royalties, cess, taxes, and other things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now to answer your second question.
What is the stiff between the government agencies and operators?
Yeah, so I think there are the ground rules that are there, the OC meetings, the MC meetings that you know you have to adhere to. So it takes a lot of time for us.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, you know, once we give our field development plans to the government,
mm-hmm.
it takes quite some time for them to come back to us to give us a DOC,
mm-hmm.
You know, for us to go and get commercial production. So there is sometimes a couple of years gap, 2 to 3 years of gap.
So are you saying it needs to be streamlined?
Yeah. So one of the things we've actually suggested to the government as a part of all the other producers under the AOGO
right.
is to actually try and come up with a development policy that allows us to. So we are telling the government that, look, we don't we don't necessarily have to wait to get all these clearances. Mm-hmm. If we as an operator think that a block, it is commercially feasible for us to develop, mm-hmm. we'll go ahead and develop it, and you give us the cost reimbursement only if we strike oil or gas.
Yeah.
So that at least that kind of shortens the process, the approval seeking
right.
process before we can get into production.
Right. Deepak, we have talked about change, as in there is a talk about change in regime, as in the way that these PSCs are being administered. Is that the right way ahead when you look at this? Because right now it's all about, if there have been issues with cost recovery, there have been technical parameters related to production and all of that. Going forward, what should be the right model? There have been all kind of models which have been talked about.
For the benefit of audience, I don't know how many of you would know what is cost recovery.
Yeah.
But
I
take it for granted that you know, and if in the question answer session you want to ask this, we can explain if required. But assuming that you know what is cost recovery, there has been...
Why don't you explain what cost recovery
okay. is? Cost recovery is an exploration production investor invests in exploration till it finds hydrocarbon. And the government provides that cost back to the investor as a first tranche after you start earning money. This is only in exploration production business. No other business provides for this kind of a provision where government allows you to recoup all your costs, including taxes. And thereafter, starts sharing whatever are the profits with the investor as well as the government. Now, this cost recovery mechanism, there have been examples in Indian production sharing contracts where an operator has quoted Utpal zero cost recovery, which means operator is volunteering to say that I do not want any cost recovery. I am happy to go with all the costs being borne by me and being shared out of this. Experience is that that operator had to go through all the procedures as if it was doing cost recovery. It was subjected to audits, it was asked to fill all kinds of returns, knowing well that through the life of the production sharing contracts.
So there's this big brother approach always around, right?
Right. So there are some contracts which have cost recovery and some very few who have volunteered and say, I want to get out of this administrative bureaucratic audits of costs just to run away from it. The government did not dispense with it. So what we are saying is that we are people who are adhering to regulations and law very scrupulously, although you're not going to be recovering costs, but we will still audit you. Now, if this is the mentality we want to keep, obviously the only solution left is that as a rule we say that there won't be cost recovery.
All right.
Okay. So what I'm saying is that the sole challenge for the operators is that they are not able to face that kind of a bureaucratic challenge. And in some other countries also, similar cost recovery, scrupulous testing, audits are put to.
I can't help but interject. So are you saying that Babus are responsible for the perils which have fallen on the sector?
Absolutely. It's the policy and regulations and the individuals
right.
which are behind that and the organizations who are expected to be administering those regulations and policies. Absolutely.
Right.
And if that's the spirit in which it is done,
right.
the operators would look for
a new
bypassing
model.
That and
yes.
a solution which is beyond that. But clearly, it is not something which is investor friendly.
Hmm.
Billions of dollars worth investments cannot be taken by investors in exploration production industry unless a cost recovery is put. So what we are saying is, we are ready to play this through a destructive mechanism. We will try this, then we will try another one, and we'll say whether the investors will be happy or not. With that mechanism, I don't think we will get investors because instability in policy is a serious challenge.
I want you to talk about, when you look at the gas infrastructure in the country, and you have been very aggressive about creating gas infrastructure in the country. But there have been, of course, there are infrastructure imperatives, but you have been facing problems elsewhere, Tamil Nadu being a case in point. How do you create this infrastructure in the way that the federal structure in the country operates?
In fact, today what has happened is land, like I said, no, as it's becoming scarce and scarce with more people getting generated on the same piece of land.
Mm-hmm.
The issue is that it has also taken a political overtone now.
Mm-hmm.
Now, every piece of land, whether it is for right of use or for permanent acquisition,
mm-hmm.
is being touted as something we are taking away from the people who are going to be using that land.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in a pipeline industry, I think it needs to be more communicated down the line to all the stakeholders. Indicating to them that, look, this is one piece of land which we are taking away from you for a short while.
Mm-hmm.
It will come back to you as it is, and you can then, and while we are taking it away, we are giving you whatever compensation the government has decided. There also, there is a need to, in a kind of, rationalize the compensations, because till now it has been last registration 10% of that, etc., which probably is a low number, people feel about it. So there's no harm in increasing that, because it's a small percentage of the large project cost, and therefore the business house which is going to benefit from it can very well absorb that.
Right.
There's no problem on that. Mm-hmm. But the other part is that when you actually give the land back to them, then even the other part is when we are actually taking away this land, we actually give crop compensation and everything which we give.
Mm-hmm.
That is there. And every time we go into the land because of any emergency or any repair work, we give them crop compensation. So that way it is very nicely compensated.
Mm-hmm.
Only issue is that once we have laid the pipeline, then it is good for agriculture. It remains like that.
Mm-hmm.
But you cannot have permanent structures on that, because you have to maintain the pipeline. You cannot have coconut trees or whatever who actually go down into the system or whatever. So that is one small restriction which happens. Although at the time of compensation, say for instance coconut trees, we calculate the complete life of the coconut tree, the bearing capacity, the fruits it will give, we calculate that, analyze it and give it to them.
Except the tensile strength of the coir as well.
But the point is, like for instance, the guy actually takes that, mm, and then he doesn't know how to invest it, so he eats it away in a two, three years time.
So
and then he's landless, no, and then it becomes an issue.
You have raised a very important issue. We are talking about land becoming a very emotive issue. There's the new land bill. How difficult the situation will become going forward, given the targets that you have in your mind?
No, I would rather say we should do it in a different manner. I'm not going to comment on the land bill except, but I'm saying that,
yeah,
the way it should be, like today we are pushing people into this.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a push factor which actually makes the person give away his land.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying that we create a pull factor. For instance, in our own management discussions, we were debating, can we try and say that, okay, if my pipeline is going through village, a particular village, right? I have the liberty at the time of planning to take it here and to this village, to that village, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So I create five options. And we have a meeting with the Gram Pradhan, etc. And we say that, okay, whoever allows us to take the village, the pipeline into your village,
mm-hmm,
we will contribute 1 crore to your system, so mm-hmm, that I will be able to do good for your own this thing. Or we will be creating an ITI here, this thing, to create skill centers here, and we will take all your people there and they will get jobs, etc., whatever.
So co-opt them.
So I'm trying to say that you create a pull factor, so the guy comes and tells you that, look, you please take the pipeline through my land.
Mm-hmm.
That is where I'm saying. So something of that kind should be done.
Right.
Or else some small tariff, etc., given to them, which actually goes and take care of the lifelong thing. But these are all connected.
Yeah, with UID now a reality, of course, link it to them so that
you can. Because
kind
if,
of, yeah,
if you have a will, there will be a solution.
Absolutely.
But if you do not have the will, then obviously you can keep on doing like this and people keep on.
Absolutely. Mr. Dugal, your views on the same. When how will the new land bill make setting up such infrastructure projects a tad bit more difficult?
Pipeline consortium building up cross-country pipelines, and in addition to that, we are already been setting the product pipelines, and LPG pipelines are also on the way.
Mm-hmm.
So this sector is, you know, extremely important for the purpose of moving bulk, you know, form of product across to the consumption points. It's something similar to what power sector has been doing in terms of laying their transmission infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's going to be extremely important that safe transportation has to happen, and pipeline is the safest possible mode. You cannot, you know, load your already crumbling freight structure, railway freight system, or even the road infrastructure cannot be relied upon in safe transportation of petroleum products. So I think some kind of a dispensation can be thought about,
mm-hmm,
in terms of
pipeline
applicability,
right,
with regards to the critical, you know, kind of mass movement of petroleum products and natural gas. I think that's one of the solution which we can think of.
Mm.
And the best kind of designers are already there in the system. You don't take it across through a populated area. Definitely it has to be through the farm lines. And you're not altering the permanent usage of land.
Right. So the new bill, how will it impact?
I don't think so. See, the issue which has to be seen is the willingness on the part of the users, and
mm,
as long as they are, you know, made part of through a compensation mechanism, I don't think so that should be a major problem.
I will pose this question to you, Deepak.
Yeah, so the quick and and important answer from corporate sector, especially in petroleum industry, is that when the bill was under discussion, the industry has prepared itself already how to deal with this.
Right. So it's already
there are many provisions in this bill which are worth opposing by anybody corporate, wherever in the world it is.
Mm-hmm.
But now that it is a reality, the corporate has taken it in stride and it will move ahead. One simple repercussion on that is going to be cost. As far as time is concerned and legalities are concerned, corporate has found a solution. Cost will have to be absorbed by the industries, by pipeline industry, and pass it on to the consumers.
Right. We have talked about some of the factors within the country that impact the gas dynamics. I would like to, some of these, but a lot of the way that these markets are, a lot of development elsewhere have a lot of impact on us as well. Particularly, I wanted to talk about the shale gas revolution and how it is changing the Indian energy spectrum as well. In fact, a lot of coal which was meant for US markets is going elsewhere now. So that is, and it's also affecting the pricing on that part. Mr. Dugal, how will you briefly mention about the shale gas? How is this shale gas revolution going to impact us?
Factored in the indexation across to the Henry Hub, and we all know that US is the largest and perhaps the only shale gas producer.
So already US is the largest producer and going to be in the days to come is going to increase its production of shale gas.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one part, is you're already aligning your domestic pricing wherein it takes in some kind of a surrogate impact of US shale gas in terms of domestic gas pricing. That's one.
Mm-hmm.
Second is also, like, you know, companies like GAIL and others, I'm sure that in the next couple of years would be looking at acquiring assets abroad and more so in the E&P side and taking it as a hedging position across in US.
Mm-hmm.
So both ways it is going to impact India in terms of pricing and availability. So we have already been able to get that US non-FTA approval. So the shale gas seems to be a reality coming across as LNG into India.
Mm-hmm.
So both way in terms of volumes as well as in terms of price is going to positively impact.
And also because we are looking at a shale gas policy here as well, where
I think that's I would rather disagree on that, because shale gas is something which the technology needs to be perfected from a geological perspective.
Right.
And I don't think so that kind of a thing is going to be thought of in the next 5 years or so.
And also,
so let's look at a position from what would happen, say, by an immediate target is 2020.
Uh-huh.
Then look at from a shale gas, once this technology gets perfected, and more so from the environmental perspective, because we know the way Europeans have been, agitating over, they have created those kind of moratoriums.
So first
that
land,
not
water.
Allowed.
So, yeah.
So those issues we have to basically, resolve in an Indian context, and till the technology gets perfected and you have an environmentally safe way of handling
and
this.
And this policy has been in the works for a long period of time. If I'm not wrong, it has been in the works for the last 2 years now.
It's been there in entire Europe. If countries like, France,
no,
they have put a moratorium.
I'm saying in Indian
context also, not only the technology, but the safe way of handling, that's going to be important.
Right. Mr. Hari, when you look at operators like Cain, and you have of course, you have the largest onshore discovery. In fact, yes, Sunday was the day when you also got a refinery, in the sense that it will take care of your whatever increase in production. It has to happen so that the refinery gets fed into 2018. How buoyant are you about the shale gas scenario in India? There are all kind of numbers which have been thrown around, from 60 CF to elsewhere.
Right. Yeah, so I think I agree with what Vijay said. I think shale is, the technology is still not fully proven on a commercial scale. There are issues of land and water. It's not like the US where there is a lot of land available that can be used in India.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, then there are all these issues of getting land. So as Cain, yes, we would be looking at shale, but I wouldn't put that as the top two priority items for us right now.
Right. One of the last topics for the panelists to discuss, and you talked about quest for resources earlier, and there is this race which is happening elsewhere. For example, we have been, of course, we would tend to believe that we have been fairly successful the way that we got some of the, OVL got some of the blocks. In fact, GAIL has secured some of the assets. But how suited are we to acquire assets overseas? We have seen an example of course, that's not gas, but we saw of course, it only be proven later, but Imperial, for example, Imperial didn't work out the way it was being envisaged. Your views on the same?
No, I would say that I still very strongly second this, that we must actually have physical molecules with yourself in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
Because your price can only ride when you have a molecule with you. Otherwise, if there is no molecule, there is no sense of any price, which you talk about. So, for instance, what Vijay mentioned was that we in GAIL have this 6 million tons of LNG from Henry Hub.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's a very different market. It can go anywhere. And in the Indian market, now we are actually looking at alternative, because here still we don't have gas to gas competition. So what we are doing is we are actually trying to invest now on large upstream shale gas or conventional assets there,
mm-hmm.
which are linked with the Henry Hub.
Right.
Now the point is that will give us a natural hedge to the extent that I will be assured of physical molecules,
mm-hmm.
and at the same time I am price insensitive. When I am saying this,
mm-hmm.
the issue is that even if the price of Henry Hub goes to $10, my production cost will still be $4.
Right.
So for me, coming and bringing gas to India, it's only I'm talking about that. I will get gas only with respect to $4 plus transportation plus liquefaction. Say $10, we'll get it here.
Mm-hmm.
Although I would be selling it off at the Henry Hub at $10 and buying it at $10. So that $6 I've hedged.
Right. Right. So having an asset in place is the way forward.
You
have Rovuma.
I would have, you know, just corroborated the point which he just made. Imperial Energy, yes, it happened.
Mm-hmm.
And typically ENP, we know that it is a 40% risk factor.
Mm-hmm.
You also get typical returns of 80 or 100%.
Mm-hmm.
But you also, you know, end up writing off losses.
Right.
So that is something which is an aberration, should not be looked at as a position that you should not be going and doing a ENP acquisition abroad. That's one.
Mm-hmm.
You look at the case of Mozambique. Now, it's a very, very extremely prolific field. And it's basically going to increase the affordability of, you know, getting that production,
mm-hmm.
of in the form of LNG,
mm-hmm.
and the whole global market is basically has to be looked into that perspective.
Right.
It's not that the molecule is supposed to head into India. Yes, you need to have an arm's length transaction. So definitely either molecule comes in or you have the price come in. So either way, you are naturally hedging the position.
Right. Right. Deepak, your views, you have been helping some of the firms firm up their overseas acquisition strategy as well. How well suited are we in this game vis-a-vis China?
Okay, so starting from basics, equity oil acquisition or equity gas acquisition is an unremovable strategy of India. It has to be done. There's no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, if you go into the depth of this analysis, seldom spoken in public forum, but I'll mention this here, is that it goes in favor of national oil companies. If national oil companies go and invest in countries for equity oil, that makes immense benefit for the country.
Mm-hmm.
Most importantly, because molecules will not necessarily travel here, you have to route it through the profits of these companies, and only national oil companies' profits will reach for the benefit of the nation,
mm-hmm.
not otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a quick answer to energy securitization through equity oil. It is the name of the game, it has to happen. The second is, are we well suited? No, obviously not.
Mm-hmm.
We're clearly not well suited for doing mega acquisitions, because what we are basically saying is that if that particular asset suits the financial appraisal of the acquiring company, and I'm taking NOC's context, the public sector oil companies,
mm-hmm.
if the public sector oil company can prove it on an Excel sheet that this particular asset is worthy of buying, only then can you buy this. Right?
Yeah.
Now, obviously, there have been so many comments made on public sector saying that they are very conservative, they don't want to take risks,
uh-huh.
that they push all the files to ministry and only make them take the decisions and not necessarily the public sector oil companies.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a votary of that particular thought, and I'm happy to take this debate on. But simply speaking, national oil companies are tied down by their shareholders.
The
they
government.
Can't do injustice to the profitability of that investment. So what do? In the world, there aren't cheap oil blocks available.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, somebody has to bail them out. If you have to go beyond the economics of buying that block at today's assumed crude oil or gas prices,
mm-hmm.
somebody has to come and bail out. So obviously, there are suggestions in the public domain saying that the country is going to form some funds which is going to take positions into making
these sovereign wealth fund has been talked about time and again. Right.
Make sure that the viability gap funding for those blocks is taken up. Or there are other businesses,
mm-hmm.
who, for example, for an oil block to be bought, you didn't necessarily have to subsidize that block through a fund created in India. infrastructure can come, company can go and make a railway line in Mozambique or some other African country and
collaborate,
make sure that that
private
happens
sector, public
and
sector.
Create a business around that. That risk, if India is going to take, if there are companies who are ready to take that kind of a funding, or soft loans are to be provided by India, which is still not there. We've been talking about it for a long time.
But also collaboration. For example, why not a private sector and public sector join hands together?
So when we do that, we'll be well suited.
Can I just add a position out here? That reminds me of, you know, fantastic, you know, there's a story going around. Then in Venezuela, blocks were on offer. The Chinese went there and they took a full shipload of the prisoners. And they were
of prisoners. Prison
and
labor. Yeah.
Basically, they turned out to be the operators of the field. And after 5 years of digging around, they were successful, and they were able to bring back the load. Whomsoever survived those, you know, hard conditions were brought back. Now that's the aggressive nature of the Chinese, the way they.
But
look
they
at
can
the,
do that.
No, there's another. I mean, we don't have to basically switch over to that kind of position, but something which they do also a subtle kind of a leveraging.
Right.
Like what Deepak was mentioning in terms of, you know, building up social infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's a very important ingredient which has to be dovetailed in when the oil companies or gas companies, they are looking for E&P acquisitions abroad.
Mm.
What other social benefits can be brought in into that place in terms of building up the infrastructure?
So of course
that's a very important key area part.
Absolutely,
of
because the various arms of the government should also kind of weigh in together.
The welcome part of this is that this kind of a realization has started happening in Indian context, and a lot of inputs are being given across to the you know, the oil companies, and MEA is basically taking that initiative.
Right.
And that initiative is basically percolating downwards, and in couple of, you know, various kind of forums have been formed. GAIL has been, you know, recently doing some kind of work on that side on the Middle East.
Yeah, in fact, they've been also looking at Pakistan.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, so out of, say, 10 initiatives, even if you're able to, you know, strike three, good. I think you have really got
a fair point to make. In fact, I know Mr. Singh has a board meeting to attend, and so we'll have a quick question and answer session.